أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين أما بعد سلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله
We were on the subject of Adhan, and I was trying to explain that in Adhan we have got to be careful when we pronounce the Arabic words. So we have observed sometimes people do not, while giving Adhan, apply the Shadda upon Illa the way it should be applied. Many a times we hear Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah or la ilaha illallah. That lam of illa is very important, that shadda is pronounced openly and clearly, because it is la ilaha illallah, and that shadda on lam must be pronounced distinctly, because it means there is no God except. That illa is to mean except. Now illa means towards, going towards. And it makes no meaning if you say la ilaha illallah. It is illallah. Now, after ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we come to ashhadu anna Amir al-Mu'mineen Aliyyan Waliullah, and that should be explained first before we understand, so that doubts are cleared. That according to our Mujtahid Ayatullah Al-Khuy, Damadillu, who has written in Minhaj al-Salihin very openly, that it is mustahab and mustahab mu'akkad, that means it is recommended and recommended with some very strongly, with some emphasis, that when you hear the name of the Prophet in Adhan, say Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad, as we do. And it should be said as loudly as we can, because we are reciprocating to the name of the Prophet. And then he writes, and it is mustahab to complete the shahadatain with the shahada of wilayat of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam in And there he has mentioned one thing, that give the witness of two things in that particular fasl of Adhan. Give the witness of he being Amirul Mu'mineen, and also he being Wali. This is main thing. That means when we say that, it is not the part of Adhan, it is the completion of Shahada. No Shahada in Iman is complete without the witness to the wilayat of Imam Ali alayhi salam. This is what we should understand. And he writes again in Minhaj al-Salihin that this does not apply to Adhan alone. Wherever it transpires that you give shahadatain, you must add this, li-ikmali shahadatain, to complete the shahadatain. So the mustahab fasl is Ashhadu anna Amir al-Mu'mineen Aliyan Waliullah. This is the mustahab part which has been recommended, that I bear witness that Ali is the master of the faithfuls, commander of the faithfuls, and he is the Wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whose love and whose to follow whom is incumbent and obligatory upon me. This is the meaning of. Now here, Amir al-Mu'mineen is Alif. There is a tendency among Mu'mineen to put Ayn there. And we hear sometimes people say, Ashhadu anna Amir al-Mu'mineen. There is no Ayn there. It is Amir al-Mu'mineen, simple Alif. The only Ayn appears in the name of Imam Ali himself. There it is Ayn. So it should be Ashhadu anna Amir al-Mu'mineen Aliyan Waliullah. Ayn is in the name of Mawla. But Amir al-Mu'mineen has got no Ayn there. It is all Hamza. Therefore, There is no need to say Amir al-Mu'mineen. It's not that. It is Amir al-Mu'mineen. Simple. Aliyan waliullah. Of course, this does not mean that if you say Aliyan hujjatullah, it will not be accepted. But exact rendering is witness to the wilaya and to Mawla being Amir al-Mu'mineen. After having said that, it is Hayya ala salah in Arabic. Wherever a noun ends with te, and if you don't want to carry it and you want to do waqf, you change this te to he. It is actually Hayya ala salati, Hayya ala salah. There is te after salah. And the word salat ends with te. But since we stop there, therefore it is Hayya ala salah. There must be that sound of hey at the end of salah. Hayya ala salah. Or if you want to join, then it will be hayya ala salati, hayya ala salah. And after that, it is hayya ala al falah, which is very important. That falah, at the end, there is hey. It is not like salah. Salah is the first hay which comes out of the mouth only. But there is falah which comes from the throat, and therefore we must understand that the meaning is hayya alal falah, run towards salvation, towards being saved. It is falah with hay. That's why I say that it be written somewhere before us so that we may read and see where there is only hay, it must be hayya alal falah. With salah, there is no hay. It is only thick hair, hayya ala salah. But when it comes to falah, it is hayya ala falah. That hay must be pronounced and it must be very clear. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq, inshaAllah. We are coming to Surah Yusuf, and only one ayah tonight, which follows immediately, is enough to cover the time. And the discussion will be a bit philosophic in a sense that it might not be very, very obvious. But we have got to ponder, because Quranic ayats are such that Ahlul Bayt salamullah alayhim ajma'in have explained each and every verse in that depth so that we understand Quran Majeed. After having said that, Yusuf told his father Yaqub that I have dreamt and I saw 11 stars, sun and the moon prostrating and bowing down before me, and Yaqub having told his son not to relate the dream to his brothers, for they might hatch a plot against him, because Shaitan is an open enemy of mankind. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kadhalik. كذلك يجتبيك ربك ويعلمك من تأويل الأحاديث ويتم نعمته عليك وعلى آل يعقوب كما أتمها على أبويك إسحاق وإبراهيم. Then Yaqub proceeded to explain the dream. He told his son now as to what is the meaning of your dream. Now before I proceed, let us understand one thing, that we have been told that whenever we dream, that dream which is a true dream, we must not relate it to anyone, asking anyone in the street, what is the meaning of this dream? Because there can be a problem. If a man does not understand the dreams, he might interpret wrongly, and he will stick it into your mind psychologically forever. And you will start believing that that man told me that this is the meaning of the dream, and therefore it goes on at the same time hinting in your mind all the time and pinching you that whatever happens is because of that. And sometimes things which would not happen also happen in life, because I have been told. So first of all, the dream, whenever we dream, a true dream, a dream which has a meaning, then it must be related, if at all one wants to relate, and to find out the interpretation, to a man who knows, because this is an ilm, it is not a joke. That is one thing. Second thing, the man who knows about it must tell that which is good and must not relate that which is bad. Otherwise he will put that man into a problem. You see, it all depends upon how you say. As I said once, if you remember, that in the days of Harun Rashid, once a palmist entered the court, a palmist. Now, you know, when a palmist enters, even if he enters here, Imam Bara, you will all leave the mullah once at one side and everybody will go and extend his palm. What is my future? But that is the illness. So when he entered with the intention of getting some money out of Harun Rashid, because he claimed that he could read the palm and tell the future. So Harun was interested, just like anybody else. And he extended his palm and he looked at it and he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And the king said, what is wrong? He said, well, what can I tell you? But you have to endure and sustain the loss of each and every relative of yours. Your son, your wife, your brothers, and many of your good friends will die, and you will sit to mourn them. You will be bereaved. It was very bad. It was very bad. The king was really disturbed. And he said, this man has come with a very bad omen today. Put him in the jail. For some time, let him be detained. He does not know even how to talk. He's giving me a very sad information. Well, the man remained in detention for some time and was forgotten. And then there came a time when nobody would talk about him. Another palmist entered with the same aspiration, ambition that I'll be paid, and he entered. But this man was a bit clever. Just as he entered, and the king knew that again the same story would start, and he gave his palm very hesitantly and said, now, he looked at him and said, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Mashallah. I said, what is there? He said, you are going to live longer than all your relatives. Now, what is the difference between your life is the longest. Everybody else in the family will have a shorter life, but yours, Mashallah, is very... And the king was so happy and so pleased. It all resulted in merriment and festivities, and not only that, the palmist was also given a lot of money. And one of the wazir, wuzara, and minister sitting there was thinking, that poor fellow is there. He said the same thing, but he did not know how to render. This man said the same thing, but he changed it that way. It depends upon how you speak. And sometimes you relate a dream to a person, he does not know how to tell you, and he tells you something, and there is a problem. For example, you go to someone and he says, well, at the age of 52, you will die. So even if you are not going to die, because death is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but at the age, as you enter 52, you will start dying from the very moment. Ghalib has said, Maut ka ek din muayyan hai, aur neend kyun raat bhar nahi aati? And elsewhere he has said, मुझे क्या बुरा था मरना अगर एक बार होता. You see, if it is only for once, but now you enter the age, bar one, and it is said, whoever enters one, enters a dangerous phase of life. So then he says, now I don't know, that man told me I will die, and that man told me I will die. This is the age on which I am supposed to pick up and go. And he might die even, just thinking of death. You don't have to tell things like that. Hazrat Yaqub does not tell Yusuf something which he must tell. He tells him that the dream that you have seen, وَكَذَلِكَ يَجْتَبِيكَ رَبُّكَ. The dream means that just as you saw it similarly, God will select you high. وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ, and will teach you the prime meaning of the events. وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ And he will complete his grace upon you and also upon the children of Yaqub. The way he completed with your grandfathers, Ishaq and Ibrahim. He didn't tell him that you cannot go there without passing through the problems. There are problems, you just can't jump. The principle is, my friends, that in this world there is no pleasure or delight, there is no ladha which is not preceded by pain. Is there? Huh? We enjoy eating when there is hunger. Hunger. That pain and that pang must be there. Then you will eat and enjoy. Thirst. Then you will drink and slake your thirst, right? And similarly, I was born here, but I do not know that my mother, who carried me as a fetus and then carried me as a child grown, ready to come to the earth, and then there were pangs of labor, as they call it. Finally, I was born. And then my mother loved me as her child. All that because of preceding labor. It doesn't happen like that. There isn't any ladha. If there had been any ladha without pain, all of us would have selected to sleep all day at home. But early morning, even if we don't rise for namaz, we rise at 4 o'clock to open our shop because there is a round. We must give the newspaper, otherwise the customers will second day complain that there was no round of newspaper. At 5 o'clock you are there, opening the shop, writing the names of everyone. All this pain we sustain for the sake of Mapesa. That pleasure which we will get at the end of having amassed some wealth is preceded by some work. It is not like that. Any work, you got to work, either it is mental or physical, but there must be some pain, as a result of which there is some ladha. Similarly, this ijtiba, ijtiba means to select. From this comes mujtaba. The name of Imam Hassan alayhi salam is Al-Hasan al-Mujtaba, means Hassan, who has been selected and purified. So kadhalika yajtabika rabbuka, Allah shall select you and purify you. And وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ And will teach you the prime meaning of the events. That means will give you that special knowledge, which is a secret. But did not tell Yusuf that this will be preceded by an ordeal. There is going to be problem for you. By the time you reach that place, you have got to give a test. He did not tell. And this is how it was. وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ Min here, in Arabic is called min littabi'ir, means Allah will not teach you every prime meaning. Some. If you remember the story of Hazrat Sulaiman, when Asif Barkhiya told him that I can bring the throne of Bilqis before even you blink. For him, Allah says, he had ilmum minal kitab. He had a knowledge, some knowledge of the book. Because of that some knowledge, he was able to bring that throne of Bilqis from so far to the court of Sulaiman. Min is called part of tabi'ir, some. And there's another ayah in Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and O Prophet, for your witness, Allah is sufficient, and he who has got ilmul kitab, that means he has got the complete ilm of book, and in all tafsir, ilmul kitab complete is Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. So to have a complete or part. He tells him that you will get a part of. Now, what is the ta'wil? Said Muhammad Hussain Tabatabai in Al-Mizan explained, it is very important that we know this because the word ta'wil has got a meaning. Ta'wil is the prime meaning. And the example is, for example, I say, please give me some water. Now, those who know English will immediately say the meaning is that he has asked for some liquid to sip, to drink, water. The meaning is clear. If you are asked to translate this into Urdu, you will translate. Into Gujarati, you will translate. The translation is over. But this is not ta'wil. This is tarjuma. Ta'wil is that this man is thirsty. And the thirst which he experienced made him ask for water. So ta'wil of asking for water is not the translation, but is that which necessitated it. And therefore ta'wil, the prime meaning is the existence of thirst. Understood? Now, let us go one step further. What is ta'wil of thirst? Then you will ask a biologist or a doctor to tell us that what changes take place in human body which cause thirst. So that is the ta'wil of the thirst. So you find that when a man says, my son, give me some water, there is ta'wil and there is a ta'wil before ta'wil. And this is called the prime meaning. Till at last, if somebody asks that why is it so that man must lose some water and then must replenish, why his body has been made that way, you will come to a place where you will say, only the maker and the creator knows. Right? So ta'wil, final stage, no one knows but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of ta'wil, not that. And that is why Allah in Quran says that this is the meaning of Quran that you are pondering upon. And nobody knows the ta'wil but rasikhuna fil ilm, those who are entrenched in knowledge, and they are Muhammad and Alu Muhammad salawatullah. And in Nahjul Balagha, Mawla says, walil Qur'an zahirun wa batin wa fi batinha butun. Quran has got an apparent meaning, exterior meaning. Behind it, there is an interior meaning. And behind that, there is further meaning. This is the meaning of it, that we may read a translation, but ta'wil is meaning behind it. So Yaqub tells him, oh my son, Allah will teach you the prime meaning of the events. Whatever takes place, you will know the ta'wil. And that is something which you will not reach without a test. And thus, he will complete his grace upon you, the way he completed his grace upon your forefathers. Yusuf did not know what is going to happen. And Yusuf did not reveal his dream. Never. Because his father told him not to. But Quran says that at the same time, his brothers were holding a meeting. There were 11 brothers. One brother was his real brother, means born of the same mother. His name was Binyamin, and in Bible, Genesis, you will see this name as Benjamin. These two, Yusuf and Benjamin, that is Binyamin, were born of one mother. The other 10 were of other mother. They were holding a meeting, and in the meeting they said that we find that our father is more paying more attention to Yusuf and his brother, that means Benjamin, while he knows that we are a group quite strong and mutually attached. Our father is in error. We must do something. So they decided in that meeting what to do. And they came to a resolution that kill him. Uqtulu Yusufa. Kill Yusuf. Awitrahuhu ardan. Or banish him to another country so that he may not be seen. What will happen is that then we will have the exclusive attention of our father. That means our father will forget about Yusuf after some time. And then we will be the people and the sons for whom he will care. Now, this is something, human psychology, that people want exclusive care, exclusive attention. Many people forget that we are living in this world, Baba, and everything for alone, myself, and exclusive attention is not possible. Is it possible? It's not possible. It cannot be possible. It is only Allah who designs it. Otherwise, if Jamaat were told to do everything for every individual, there'll be havoc. Because in a simple sitting that we have sometimes, somebody raises his hand, a thali ma gosht nahi. For example, or a particular volunteer, why didn't you first come and serve me? It happens. Now, that volunteer is serving the Ummah. He can forget one, he can go there, he can... He doesn't mean to ignore you. But I mean it because I have been ignored and that I is working. So, we will have exclusive attention. Allahu Akbar. And it ends this way. And then after having killed him or sent him away, so that he is lost and forgotten, then we will become good people. This is Quran Ajib. That means, as I say, I am a young man, inshallah, I will pray when I am old. I'll be good. Oh yes, I'll definitely good. See? But at the moment I do whatever, I lie, Allah Ghafurur Rahim. You see? But when I grow old, I promise, I'll pray, I'll fast, and I will go to Hajj. When I grow old. At the moment, life is for enjoyment and merriment. Same psychology, Allah says, that these brothers in their meeting said, that kill him or banish him far away so that he is not seen. And after having done all this, we will be good, inshallah. Nakuna min as-salihin, we'll be good. And Allah will forget everything. One man stood up among the brothers and said, don't kill him. Don't kill him. Put him in the deepest and at the bottom of the well. That means throw him in the well. فَأَلْقُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبِّ. Jub is a well. Ghayaba is so deep that he can't be seen. Rather than killing him or banishing him, what we can do is just put him in this well. And what will happen is that any caravan passing from here, when it will put its bucket inside to bring out water, Yusuf will have ways of at least shaking the rope or sitting into the bucket and he'll come out. It will be his destiny. But we should not kill him. We should only throw him into the well. And this was unanimously resolved by all the brothers, that what we will do is, we'll put him in the well. Rahim. Alhamdulillahi alladhi la yablughu midhatahu alqailun.